Dear students, today lesson is an introduction to statistics. In this, apart from introduction, we will give information about data, how the data presentation in the form of charts and diagrams, and in the case of health survey, we will have the sampling techniques. So sampling and there are types of sampling that will give information in this lesson. After completing this lesson, I am going to give assessment for you on the topic of nutrition. There are 20 MCQ questions that you have to answer after completion of this lesson. The origin of statistics roots from Greek word statis, which means state. The birth of statistics occurred in mid 17th century. Gron, who was a shopkeeper, organized this data, which was published as a natural and political observations made upon the bills of mortality. The 17th century contribution of theory of probability laid the foundation of modern statistical methods. Statistical methods are fruitfully applied to any problem of decision making where the past information is available or can be made available. It helps to weigh the evidences and draw conclusions. Statistics finds its application in almost all the fields of science. It helps the researcher to arrive at a scientific judgment about a hypothesis. The most important application of statistics in sociology is in the field of demography. Generally, the definition of statistics means the science which deals with the collection, presentation, analysis, and interpretation of numerical data. Definition of biostatistics here defined as the application of statistical methods to medical, biological, and public health related problems. It is the scientific treatment given to the medical data derived from group of individuals or patients. The role of statistics in public health and community medicine. Statistics finds an extensive use in the public health and community medicine. Statistical methods are found for public health administrators to understand what is happening to the population under their care at community level as well as individual level. If reliable information regarding the disease is available, the public health administrator is in a position to assess community needs, understand socio-economic determinants of health, plan experiment in health research, analyze the results, study diagnosis and prognosis of disease for taking effective action. Scientifically, test the efficiency of new medicines and methods of treatment. In the simplest form, meaning of statistics means data or numerical observation. Then what are the data? Data means collection of facts. What is information? Information is the outcome of data analysis and interpretation. In the simplest way, biostatistics, this is the statistics related to living or human beings. Vital statistics means data on vital events like births, deaths, and marriages, etc. Health statistics, data related to health service system or organizations and institutions. It includes all data required for planning, implementation, and evaluation of health services or health system. There are two types of data, according to the strength of the scale of measurement. Qualitative, in this we'll find qualitative binary, qualitative nominal and qualitative ordinal. These are not measurable. These are classified only by counting the units that have same attribute. These data have no magnitude. For example, sex, male or female, color and race. Qualitative binary data, the variables can, one variable can only two values such as male or female, yes or no, cured or not cured, vaccinated, not vaccinated, exposed, not exposed. These data can be represented by pie diagram or simple table by frequency distribution. So same qualitative binary data in the form of pie diagram, frequency distribution table, or simple table. Student number one, actual points, possible points, grade, student two, student three. This is a qualitative binary data in a diagrammatic representation. Qualitative nominal data, the variable can take more than two values or any value. The information fits into one of the category. The categorizer cannot rank it. Example, nationality or state to which one belongs, to spoken language, blood group. These data can be represented frequency distribution in a tabular form or by using horizontal bar chart. Qualitative ordinal data, the variable can take number of values that can be ranked through some gradient. For example, birth order of the child, first child, second, third, and severity of the illness, mild, moderate, severe. Nutritional status, normal, moderate, severe, underweight. Social status also, lower middle, middle, upper middle, upper class. These data can be presented by frequency distribution table or vertical diagram. Now, quantitative data. There are two types of quantitative data, descriptive and continuous. Quantitative discrete data, values are distinct and repeated. Normally, values have no decimal and whole and are whole numbers. Example, number of sexual partners, parity, or number of persons died of measles, number of beds in hospital, and white cell count. These data can be represented by frequency distribution table or histogram. Data of onset of disease in epidemic can be displayed by histogram or epidemic curve and long-term trend by line diagram. Quantitative continuous data. These data can assume continuous, uninterrupted, infinity number of possible values in any interval. Values may have decimals. Example, weight, height, hemoglobin, temperature. Quantitative continuous data can be measured by an interval scale, which is characterized by the numerical unit of measurement. Example, body temperature measured on interval scale and units of measurement is degree Celsius. Interval scales can have negative values as temperature can be minus 20 degrees Celsius. The ratio scale has all characteristics of interval scale as well as true or absolute zero. So that ratio between two values on the scale are meaningful or relatively magnitude of the two measurements. Example, height in meters and weight in kgs, no values exist below zero in this scale. The continuous quantitative variable or data can be presented by frequency distribution table or a diagram such as histogram. presentation of statistics. After the data has been collected, it has to be sorted out and presented properly for analysis and interpretation. It aids the reader in quick understanding of complicated data. There are two main methods of presentation. One is the tabulation form and a drawing. Tabulation, three types of tables are in use, namely master table, simple table, and frequency distribution table. The following points should be kept in while making such tables. The class interval must be same throughout, and number of groups should not be unduly large. The headings should be clear. If the data are expressed in rates or proportions, this should be specified. If some data are omitted, this reason should be explained. So we can draw either histogram, frequency polygon, frequency curve, line chart diagram, bar diagram, scatter or dot diagram, pie or sector diagram, map diagram or spot map. Histogram, it is a graphical presentation of frequency distribution. The character of different groups is indicated on horizontal axis or abscissa, while frequency is indicated on vertical axis or ordinate. The frequency of each group forms a column or rectangle. The height of frequency rectangles vary, and the area of the rectangle represents the frequency. Frequency polygon, it is a simple, a derived from histogram obtained by joining the midpoints of various histogram blocks. Frequency curve, when the number of observations is very large, the polygon loses the angulations and it becomes a frequency curve. The frequency polygon and curve are drawn for presenting quantitative and continuous data. Line chart or graph, it shows the trend of an even over a period of time. The trend may indicate rise, fall, or fluctuations in occurrence of the event. Bar diagram, the length of the bar indicates the frequency, which is usually marked on the vertical line. The characteristic is shown on the baseline, such as diagram presents a relative values of qualitative character in the discrete data, such as morbidity in different sexes, professions or places. The bar may be drawn in ascending or descending order or magnitude as appropriate. Scatter or dot diagram, a graphic presentation is made here to show the extent and nature of correlation between two variables such as height and weight. Hence, it is called a correlation diagram. Varying frequencies of two characters in the same individual or one character in two different individuals, such as height of the father and sons. Again, number of meeting. Points or dots that shows a scatter. A line is drawn to show nature and extent of the correlation at a glance. Pie or sector diagram, the data are presented in a circle. Degree of angles and the area of sectors denote the relative frequency of the character. Map diagram or spot map, these maps are prepared to show the geographical distribution of frequency of characteristics. A dot or point indicates a unit of occurrence. For example, one dot may mean 10 attacks or 10 deaths. Fractions are to be ignored. Two dots, the two different colors on the map of the country may show two different characteristics, such as attacks and the death in different areas. Spot may help in locating are pinpointing the index case in an epidemic. If the map shows clustering of cases, it may suggest a common source of infection or common environmental factor shared by all the cases. So here the simple line, this line chart and simple bar chart mapping out easy. Here also the histogram, frequency, polygon and curve. This is a pie diagram. Broad categories of statistics, descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. Descriptive statistics, it deals with the meaningful presentation of data such that its characteristics can be effectively observed. It encompasses the tabular, graphical or pictorial display of data, condensation of large data into tables, preparation of summary measures to give a concise description of complex information. Inferential statistics, it refers to decision. Medical research does not stop at just describing the characteristics of the disease or situation. It tries to determine whether characteristics of a situation are unusual or if they have happened by chance. Because of this desire to generalize, the first step is to statistically analyze the data. In order to begin our analysis as to why statistics is necessary, we must begin by addressing the nature of science and experimentation. The characteristic methods used by researcher, who or she starts the experimenting while studying a relatively small collection of subjects as complete population-based studies, are time-consuming, laborious, costly, and resource-intense. The researcher draws a subject of population called a sample and studies this sample in depth. The conclusion drawn after analyzing the sample is not restricted to the sample but extrapolated to the population, that is, people in general. Sampling methods. To draw conclusion about population from sample, there are two major requirements for sample. First, sample size should be adequately large. Second, sample has to be selected appropriately so that it is representative of the population. Sample should have all characteristics of population. In other words, a sample is expected to be mirror of the population from which it comes. Sampling is concerned with the selection of representative sample, especially for the purpose of statistical inference. The idea of sampling is very old, and from time immemorial, people have used it in day-to-day life. For example, housewife examines one or two grains of cooked rice to ascertain whether rice is ready to eat or not. Thus, on the basis of sample study, we can predict and analyze the behavior of the population. For sampling purpose, the important techniques adopted in medical research, namely simple random sampling, stratified random sampling, systematic random sampling, cluster sampling, multi-stage sampling. Simple random sampling. In this method, the individual units constitute the sample are selected at random. Each unit in the population has equal chance or probability to selected in the sample. It is sometimes referred as a probability sample. Two types of random sampling. Simple random sampling with replacement, simple random sampling without replacement. in SRS with the replacement, the selected unit is replaced back to the population again as the chance of getting selected. In SRS without replacement, which is usual method in medical research, the selected unit is not put back in the population, hence the population size reduces by one at each selection. Random samples can be drawn by lottery method or by using random number tables. The advantage of simple random sampling is that subjectivity is completely eliminated, as each subject has an equal chance of getting selected. Simple random sampling is very scientific, but the practical problem is that it may be quite difficult, often impossible, to make a complete list of all subjects in the population from which the sample is to be selected. Stratified random sampling. The population here is heterogeneous with respect to the characteristics under study. In this method, complete population is divided into homogeneous subgroups called strata, and then a stratified sample is obtained by independently selecting a separate sample random sample from each population stratum. This gives equal chances to the units in each stratum to be selected as sample. The total sample is addition of samples of each stratum. Population can be divided into different groups on some characteristics or variable like income or education. The advantage of this sampling procedure is that each subgroup, however small, has a representation in the total sample. Systematic random sampling is commonly employed technique when complete and up-to-date list of sampling units is available. A systematic random sample is obtained by selecting one unit on random base and then choosing additional units at evenly spaced intervals until the desired number of sample size is obtained. For example, if there are 100 students, capital N, in a class, and then we wish to select a sample of 20 students, small n, from them by systematic random sampling procedure, then the first step is to write the name of the 100 students in alphabetical order or their roll numbers one below the other. In the systematic sampling procedure, we divide n by small n to get sampling fraction k. Thus, in example, there are 100, we need 20 samples. So 100 by 20 is 5. We randomly select any number between 1 to 5. Suppose the number we select is 4, then the student roll number 4 is selected in the sample. Thereafter, every k is the student is selected in the sample unit, we reach the last one. Thus, the student corresponding number is 4, 9, 14, 99, so on, or selected in a sample. The advantage of systematic sampling is that it is easier to draw, but the demerits is that sample may exhibit a pattern or periodicity. Clustered sampling. Cluster sampling is used when the population is heterogeneous. Clusters are formed by grouping units on the basis of their geographical location. A cluster sampling is obtained by selecting clusters from the population on the basis of simple random sampling. From the selected clusters, each and every unit is included for the study. Cluster sampling is very useful method for the field epidemiological research and health administrators. A special form of clustered sampling called 30 cluster sampling has been recommended by World Health Organization for field studies in assessing vaccination coverage among the children. In this, a list of all villages, that is clusters, for a given geographical area is made. 30 clusters are selected using probability proportional to size. From each of the selected clusters, 7 subjects are randomly chosen. Thus, the total sample of 30 × 7 is 210 subjects is chosen. The advantage of clustered sampling is that sampling frame is not required, and in the practice, when complete lists are rarely available, clustered sampling is suitable. We have utilized this type of method in evaluation of immunization program in the ICDS, where the immunization program is better, or the non-ICDS place where immunization. So we have done this clustered sampling technique. Multi-stage sampling. In this method, the whole population is divided in first stage sampling units from which a random sampling is selected. The selected first stage is then subdivided into second stage units from which another sample is selected. Third and fourth stage sampling is done in the same manner if necessary. For example, an urban survey in the state, a sample of towns may be taken first. Then in each selected towns, a second stage sampling households may be taken. If needed further from the each of the selected household, a third stage sampling of individual may be selected. Since the samples are selected at each stage, the method is called multi-stage sampling. That is the end of the lesson. Now we have to follow the assessment, nutrition and health. There are 20 MCQ questions. It is based on the chapters. Thank you.